That was an extraordinarily generous introduction. Thank you very much. Vice Admiral Ranasinghe, Rear Admiral Petty Arachi, Commander Artigala, people who have been directly responsible for my stay here, and the base commander, of course, who was kind enough to slow down his morning walk to accompany me. Thank you very much, Rear Admiral Artigala. It's an enormous privilege and a pleasure, actually more than that, an honor to be here with you this morning. I'm deeply touched that I have been asked to come and to be here with you for the 2018 Logistics Conference of the Sri Lanka Navy. Now, everybody in this room will know more than I do about logistics. And also during the course of the day, you're going to hear from experts on the subject of an international financial center. So I hope you will permit me to paint a broader canvas and talk about some of the strategic challenges Sri Lanka needs to address if we are to build a vibrant economy and a prosperous country. So that I would like to make the overarching theme of my remarks this morning. And I'd like to structure my remarks by initially making the case that this is probably the most propitious, most favorable set of circumstances Sri Lanka has had for maybe 50 years. And then I'd like to go on to talk a little bit about the growth model that is being put in place at present, and then to speak about how that growth model can be implemented in terms of establishing macroeconomic stability and strengthening the growth framework, and finally to give you a flavor about some of the development projects that are being implemented. So why do I say this is the most propitious set of circumstances for over 50 years? If you go back to the late 1950s, for about 25 years, on a continuous basis, Sri Lanka experienced a secular and dramatic decline in its terms of trade. What do I mean by that? The prices of our key export commodities, Sri Lanka was basically a tea, rubber, and coconut exporting commodity at that time. The prices of those commodities declined on a long-term basis. At the same time, the prices of our imports increased. So there was this twin effect of these twin effects serve to lead to the decline of what economists call the terms of trade. So at the time when the surpluses in the economy was coming down, in those 25, 30 years after the late 1950s, our population increased dramatically. So there was demographic pressure on the one hand, and the surpluses coming down on the other. These twin effects were major drags on the development prospects of the country. Also, as a response to these pressures, the governments of that time adopted inward-looking policies to protect the economy from the vagaries of a global economy which was dealing our economy such severe blows. However, with the benefit of hindsight, we can now say that that was not the right direction to take, because for a relatively small economy, a relatively small market with relatively low purchasing power, the inward-looking, autarkic or self-reliant policies that we pursued were not appropriate. So, in addition to the terms of trade declining, population going up, we also put in place economic policies which were not appropriate for an economy with our characteristics. Then, of course, from the early 1980s, we had the 30-year conflict, which was again a major, major drag on the development prospects of the country. Now, at present, we don't have any such major drags, which are constraining our development prospects. Not only that, we are located in Asia, the most dynamic region in the world. We are 20 miles from the fastest growing large economy in the world, in India. And we are very close within India to the five southern states which have been experiencing double-digit growth for a number of years now. We are slap bang in the middle of China's maritime Silk Route. We are equidistant from the East and the West. We have easy access to East Africa and the Middle East. So it's an extraordinary location. And it is this location that made Sri Lanka for millennia a trading hub in the middle of the Indian Ocean. So now we need to rediscover our roots and to again build ourselves up as an economic hub in the middle of the Indian Ocean, which is, as you know better than I do, is receiving increasing attention from all the powers in the world. So that, in terms of not having any major drags compromising our prospects, having this wonderful location, in my view, gives us the best opportunity we've had for over 50 years. So what is being done to try to take advantage of these prospects? The government has put in place a growth strategy. It's laid out in its Vision 2025, which is based on the private sector being the engine of growth and with a key role for exports and foreign direct investment. Now, why the private sector? I have been a public servant all my life. I am not a person who thinks that the private sector is the provides the panacea for all our ills. But the fact of the matter is, our public debt and our fiscal deficit is such that the government simply does not have the money to drive the development. That is taken for granted. But you have to grow the cake before you can think of redistributing it. And so that, without exports, it's going to be very difficult to achieve those growth rates. If you look at countries as large as China, successful countries as large as China or as small as Singapore, exports have been a major part of their economic transformation. Then the next step is, none of these countries have achieved export expansion without a significant role for FDI. Japan and Korea are different. It was an earlier period and their growth process was different. But after that, all the countries in Southeast Asia, Taiwan, China, all of them, had an important place for FDI in bringing about their economic transformation. FDI brings in capital, it brings in know-how. More than anything, it's probably the know-how that's important. It brings in markets, and it often brings in managerial capability as well. So that's why I say that the growth model, which the government has adopted, in my view, is appropriate. So private sector, exports, FDI. Now, to make this growth model successful, there are three changes we have to make in terms of mindset, paradigm shifts. One is, we have been extremely successful in terms of social development. If you look at the UNDP's Human Development Index, if you look at performance under the Millennium Development Goals, Sri Lanka has been an outperformer. We have done extremely well. But I would put to you that we haven't got the balance between human development, social development, and growth and wealth creation right. Now, you may well ask the question, look, with all these excellent outcomes in terms of social indicators, why are you saying that the balance is not right? And there I would put to you that despite all the success we've had in terms of social development, we've had two youth insurrections in the South and a separatist conflict which metamorphosed into a terrorist war in the North. And that is because we have not been able to meet the expectations and aspirations of our young people in terms of creating high-value jobs which gives them a decent livelihood. So it's not just enough to have social development. What that actually does is it increases aspirations and expectations. You have then to be able to deliver the livelihoods and employment and the income that the young people who get educated require. And that's where we've had this mismatch between expectations and opportunities. And that's why I say we need to adjust that balance between social development. We have to see how we grow the cake and give importance to that as well, without compromising our objectives in terms of social development. But we need to push harder on the factors that give us development, growth, and increases in employment. So that's one paradigm shift. The second paradigm shift in terms of mindset change that we have to absorb is that for many years, as a low-income country, we were recipients of very generous levels of foreign aid. Because we were the second country after Chile to liberalize our economy in 1977. So the traditional donors, mainly the West and Japan, were very keen to show good development outcomes in a country that had liberal economics and a democratic polity. That was the model they wanted to push. They were keen to show good outcomes. They gave us a lot of foreign aid. With the benefit of hindsight, that wasn't as positive as it could have been, because it got us into bad habits. Because we basically lived beyond our means and survived on these large amounts of foreign aid that we got. But now we have graduated to lower middle income country status, and we no longer have access to highly concessional foreign aid. In the past, we got about 5% of GDP average a year as foreign aid. Now we have to go out to international capital markets and borrow that money. Foreign aid came, two-thirds of it came from the concessional windows of the World Bank and ADB. 10-year grace period, less than 1% administration charge. And bilateral donors, the maximum interest was about 1.5% or 2%. Now we have to go into markets and borrow at about 6%. And also the tenure is between 3 and 10, sometimes even shorter than 3 years, but maximum 10 years. So we are borrowing on much stiffer terms. And not only that, in the past, if we had, before an election, often we let go and we have very loose policies. Successive governments have done that. And then we have a crisis and we get bailed out with concessional money. Now if we do that, the rating agencies will downgrade us and it becomes very difficult for us to go and borrow the money that we need. Because we need to borrow over the next 5 years about 2.5 billion US dollars a year. And so we have to have the rating and the market access to do that at reasonable rates of interest. If the markets see that we are being indisciplined, they will punish us. They will downgrade, rating agencies will downgrade us, and at a minimum we'll have to pay high interest rate, or we may even not have access to international capital markets at all, which is a Greece type scenario. Now we're nowhere near that. But this is something we now need to understand, that we are in a new paradigm, in a new situation. We can no longer rely on foreign aid to help us to bail ourselves out. We are exposed to rating agencies and capital markets, and they are brutal, as we've seen in Greece, recently in Argentina, in many countries. And the austerity that is imposed on the people, if you have that kind of crisis, is worse than anything we have experienced so far. So what I'm saying is we have to have a different mindset. We have to be more disciplined in the way we manage our economy. There's a much higher premium attached to prudent and disciplined economic management. The third mindset change we need to absorb is, when I first talked about this to my colleague, Mrs. Tenneco, the Chief of Staff, she said, we are getting old before we got rich, which means that we are experiencing aging at a much earlier stage of the development process. And that has important implications. Of course, it has implications in terms of healthcare, in terms of the support that we have to give an aging population. But there is also a very fundamental problem. In the sense that when you have a young population, each age cohort is a young and increasing population. Each age cohort is larger than the next. So you can drive a certain amount of growth simply by increasing your labor force. More people work, more people produce some output, and so you have some growth. What happens when you have an aging population and you can't add an increasing number of people? You can no longer drive growth through augmentation of people into the workforce. That places a much higher premium on increasing productivity, which is much tougher than simply adding people. So what is happening is that we are having to focus much more on increasing productivity at an earlier stage in our development process. Of course, you know, we are facing this situation in a way because of, we are being penalized for our success. Why we are having this aging process so early is because our free education system, which has been accessible to girls as much as boys, has meant that our voluntary family planning programs have been extremely successful. Because the mother has been educated and been able to plan the family. But the downside is that we are having to have to focus on productivity at a much earlier stage of our development process. And what that means is we need to have more innovation, more research, all those things at an earlier stage of the development process than lots of other countries who have aged at a later process, later stage of their development process. So these are three things we need to take on board in terms of the strategic orientation we need to adopt to drive our development process forward. Okay, so I've talked about the growth model, I've talked about the mindset change, what is being done to stabilize the economy. Historically, we've had difficulty in having strong macroeconomic fundamentals. And the main source of instability in the system has been our budget deficit. And it's been very tough for us. We have a very adversarial competitive political system, and that makes budget discipline difficult. Of course, this adversarial and political system has given us freedom for 70 years. It has given us free education and health. It has given us social mobility. So you can't write it off completely, but it has also made budget discipline very difficult. But as I said, now with exposure to rating agencies, international capital markets, we have to have a different approach. We have to be more disciplined. Otherwise, we'll have a very serious repercussions. So what is being done to try to achieve that? So the government has a fiscal consolidation program based on enhancing revenue, which is why you have seen the VAT reforms, which is why you have seen a new Inland Revenue Act, that we really have to increase revenue. Our revenue slipped to about 12% of GDP. In the 1980s, I worked in the finance ministry, our revenue was 21% of GDP. So that's been a major slippage. Partly because we've had to give away a lot of concessions, because during the war there was a war risk premium attached to the economy which had to be addressed, so the government gave a lot of concessions. But now, ex post the war, that has to be addressed and we have to increase revenue. And that's why you're seeing these reforms. They're not popular, they're difficult, but we have to do them. And we are trying also to institutionalize this improvement by putting in place fiscal rules, which says, at the moment we have a Fiscal Management Responsibility Act which has a target for the fiscal deficit and for debt as a percent of GDP, but it was introduced in 2002, but in every, I think pretty much, we have breached it. But going forward, we're trying to give teeth to the Fiscal Management Responsibility Act, whereby the Act will be amended to specify particular reasons when the targets can be breached, i.e. if you have a natural disaster and you have to provide relief, or you have a massive external shock and the economy goes into recession and the government has to spend money to boost the economy to get it going again. So there will be particular reasons why you can breach the target, but when you breach it, you have to give a plan as to how you will come back to meet the target again. So that's what the government is moving towards. On monetary policy, which is in the central bank's hand, we are introducing what is known as a flexible inflation targeting regime. I don't want to go into a lot of technical detail, but we're trying to make monetary policy more forward-looking and proactive, and we've strengthened our modeling and forecasting capability to do that. And we are amending the Monetary Law Act to provide the legal and accountability frameworks to have a more independent central bank. In fact, in some countries, the flexible inflation targeting regime is based on an inflation target, which the government sets and then the central bank has to meet. And part of the accountability is that if the target is missed, the central bank governor has to resign. So I think that's a pretty good one to have, I think, to bring about discipline. So we are institutionalizing through amending the Monetary Law Act, and we're introducing this flexible inflation targeting regime. On the exchange rate also, we're working on building certain parameters within which the exchange rate should be managed. The importance of that has been shown in recent days when there has been what in our view in the central bank, undue pressure on the exchange rate. But now we're going to work out certain parameters which will then make it transparent as to how we would respond to such situations in the future. I hope in the coming months we will be able to set those parameters out so there will be a transparent process. And the government has enacted the Active Liability Management Act, which will enable the Treasury and the Central Bank to more actively manage our public debt obligations, particularly our external debt obligations. In the past, you could borrow money only for a particular year's government borrowing requirement. You couldn't borrow additional money, if the condition was suitable, to build up buffers to manage the debt that is coming up ahead of us. So now we will have more headroom, more flexibility to build these buffers and to manage our external liabilities, which are bunched over the next 5 years in a more active way. So that will also give us a better chance of dealing with this situation. It's a manageable situation, provided we don't make it worse by increasing the borrowing of the government. So those are the frameworks that are being put in place. The performance of the public enterprise sector has also been a drain on the economy. It has absorbed a lot of resources, both financial and human, and not given us a very high rate of return. And one of the reasons why you had this pricing adjustment formula for fuel that was introduced recently is to address that. There's going to be a more cost-reflective way of pricing fuel going forward. There's also a commitment to do that for electricity. I think one of the things we need to figure out is how we are going to protect those who need protection. Every society has to protect its poor and vulnerable. But in the past, we have tended to try to do that through generalized subsidies. And often what happens is the better off actually get more of the benefits than the poor and vulnerable. So we need to have a targeted, much better targeted system of income transfers. It could be vouchers, it could be other ways. Now the Indians have this Aadhaar card. We are also working towards a biometric ID card. And so we can identify the poor and vulnerable who need support. And then you can transfer income, like the Samruddhi program. You can transfer the income they require through their mobile phones. Many people in Sri Lanka have mobile phones, a bank account, because of the remittances experience. So there are ways in which you can actually have a much more targeted approach to protecting the poor and vulnerable. And the government is working on it. It's going to be tough, politically tough. I suspect it'll have to be in a different electoral cycle. But we need to move to that. Because as I said, we can no longer rely on concessional money to come and bail us out. We're borrowing money at very expensive rates. So if we are going to give support, which we must do, then we must give it to the deserving in a targeted way and find a way of doing that. And targeted income transfers around the world have proved to be the best way of supporting the poor and vulnerable. So that's in terms of some of the macroeconomic stabilization measures that have been taken. In terms of some, to give you a flavor of some of the development programs, we're in Tripoli, so let me start there. Subhana Durong, the Singaporean consultancy which prepared the Megapolis plan, is also preparing a development plan for Trincomalee and the Trincomalee area. And the idea is for the Sri Lankan government to work with Japan and India to develop this area. So in addition to developing the harbor and the logistics around the harbor, the idea is to have leisure, commercial and residential real estate, an industrial zone in the hinterland. So Japan and India will take the lead in implementing this development plan going forward, which will benefit not only the East, but also the Rajarata. So the idea is to develop Trincomalee as a hub, which will create economic activity to the benefit of that whole segment of the country. Then if you come down, there is a route from Trincomalee through Kandy, Colombo to Hambantota. That is a corridor the government is trying to develop. So you have Trincomalee first, then Japan is developing a master plan for Kandy. And the idea there is to make it a culturally sensitive development plan, which takes advantage of the religious heritage, as well as some economic activity zone, which focuses more on the IT sector and services rather than heavy industry. Then you come down the central highway towards Kurunagala, an industrial zone in Bingiriya. Then you come to Colombo, you have the Megapolis plan, as well as the port city, where you have the international financial center. And then you go further south, again, an industrial zone developed by the Thais, a Thai company in Kalutara. Then a big tourism development in Dedua, and then of course Hambantota. I would like just to say a few words about the long lease of the Hambantota port, because it's been the focus of much debate. In my own personal view, we shouldn't look at it just as a long lease of the port. It is actually an area development plan. The Chinese, in the first phase, in addition to further developing the port, are planning to have what they call five foundational industries: an LNG plant, a refinery, a steel billet factory, a cement factory, and a ship repair facility. And those foundational industries will then support the rolling out of an industrial zone. I mean, they initially asked for 15,000 acres. Whether we can give them 15,000 acres, I don't know. But anyway, the idea is to build an industrial zone. Now, I think if we are honest, we must admit that we've been independent for 70 years, but very little has been done for the people of Monragala, for the people of Uva, and even the people of Hambantota have some assets, but which are not really working for them. So what this long lease of the port to China Merchant can do is to trigger development of that whole area, Hambantota, Monragala, Uva. Now, you must remember that these are the heartlands of the JVP movement. So these are lagging regions which we have not been able to develop for 70 years. And this long lease of the port gives us a chance to transform those lagging regions. So I think really when we look at that lease, that's how we should look at it. It's an opportunity to develop a lagging region in the country. I should also say, for the conflict affected areas, the government has a new incentive scheme whereby it is giving investment allowances. That is, you can write off against tax the amount of your investment. So if, and it's 100% allowances in the country. So if you invest $10 million, you can write off $10 million against profit. And then, of course, you can also have depreciation of your investment over 5 years. So it's in fact a 200% write-off. For the conflict-affected areas in the north and the east, the investment allowance is 200%. So you can write off 300% of your investment against your tax. So that's the new incentive scheme that's been given. And of course, the Makakatanthura Airport and the Palali Airport are being developed again. And the road and the railway are working again. So those areas are also being looked after. Now, one thing I must say is, a lot of what I've told you is still on paper. Some of it is being implemented, has been implemented. Some of it is being implemented. But what we really need to do is to get this thing, this stuff done. That is where there has been a weakness. It has to be implemented, and it has to be implemented quickly for the benefit of the whole country. Because we do have, in my view, very good plans. But it's going slower, too slowly. So what are the priorities, in fact, for the future? It's got to be implementation, implementation, and implementation. Those are the top three priorities. We need to get what we have, the plans which we have in place, implemented. Let me finish by quickly saying, as I said, we have a wonderful location. So when you come to a logistic conference, that has to be at the front and center of one's mind. With this location, you know, we can leverage a great deal. Every major power in the country is interested in the Indian Ocean. Every major power in the country is interested in Sri Lanka, which is in the middle of the Indian Ocean. The crucial location. So we need to take advantage. We are a non-aligned country. We are friends with everybody. We need to develop commercial relations with everybody while taking into account the realities of our geographical position. And that's something of obviously we have to have in the back of our minds. But that still leaves a lot of space for us to collaborate with Japan, China, Southeast Asia, India, all the countries which have surpluses they are looking to invest. And we have a very solid human resource base. We need to fine-tune our education, training, and skills development so that we support the new modernizing sectors that are coming on stream. At the moment, there is a misalignment between our comparative advantage as an economy and the labor market and our education, training, and skills development. So we need to align that better. And that, again, work is being done on it, but it needs to get implemented. So the bottom line is, best chance in 50 years. Plans are good. We need to get it done. Thank you very much.